They're tuning up.
I know they are, dear. I can hear them.
Well, how do you feel?
Terrible.
Oh, good. So do I. See ya.
They're tuning up.
I know, darling. I can hear them.
Now, Mary, I'm worried. I'm worried about you.
Well, don't be. It'll be all right on the night.
Yeah, but this is the night, and it may not be. Particularly if you insist on doing the one thing that I've implored you not to do.
Now, Noel, we're not back to that again, are we?
Mary, I wish you wouldn't be so obstinate about this. There's still time to cut it.
Well, there's still time to cut my throat, but I don't intend to.
You got it hopelessly wrong when you were rehearsing it yesterday.
Well, that was yesterday, and this is today, and I've been rehearsing it all night.
You'll be asked to leave the hotel.
Well, now, you don't have to worry about that. We're very high up, and the woman underneath is deaf.
Cause and effect, I presume.
This is no time to be witty, dear. A little later on, when we're out there under all those scorching lights, you can be as witty as all get out, but not now. I can't stand it.
Well, I can't stand the idea of 90 million people looking at you doing something you're really not very good at.
How do you know I'm not very good at it?
Well, I've never heard it right through. You've never sung it right through.
Well,
yes, you
did. I did. I rehearsed it over and over again, and my Richard was delighted.
I bet he was.
He said it was perfect, and you know my husband never says anything like that unless he really means it.
He was probably demented from lack of sleep. No wonder he looks haggard.
Richard does not look haggard. He may be a little bit on the thin side, but he's not haggard.
A little bit on the thin side. He's nothing but skin and bone. He's aged 10 years since we started rehearsing. My heart bleeds for Richard.
Now, you don't have to worry about Richard. You just concentrate on your own troubles. And, honey, they're coming closer by the minute.
What do you mean by that?
Look, I've been in television before. You haven't. You just wait till you get out there with all those cameras swirling about you and your mouth as dry as a bone.
Don't, dear. Please don't. Don't.
Think of all the thousands of people in those clean American homes crouching over their sets just staring at you.
I don't see any particular necessity for them to crouch over their sets. Unless they've built their clean American ceilings too low.
There's a dangerous note of British superiority in your whole attitude. Now, that's not the way to make the American public love you, and you do want them to love you, don't you?
Certainly I do. I want them to love you, too. And they won't if you insist on singing something that is vocally beyond your range.
It is not vocally beyond my range. You know perfectly well I have two voices, and I've been training them both for years.
I don't care if you've got eight voices. That sort of music, darling, doesn't suit you.
Noel, we agreed weeks ago that this program needed contrast and variety.
I know we did.
Noel, dear, let's get this clear. It's really too late for bickering. The warning lights are flickering. We mustn't fool about.
Now, that's okay, but let me say, before we go any farther, dear, oh, I'd really so much rather, dear, you cut that number out.
Noel?
Apart from slowing up the pace, it really isn't strong enough.
Without that number in that place, our program won't be long enough.
90 minutes is a long, long time. A long, long time. A long, long time.
To make people laugh for an hour and a half in this very exacting medium.
Not to expect, and the final effect may be nothing but tears and tedium.
Don't imagine that we've not rehearsed. We did that first, but fear the worst. We hope your music customers with music and with rhyme. But 90 minutes is a long, long time. 90 minutes is a long.
Every man's life when he must take his son aside and teach him the facts of life about automobile engines. Let's see what we can learn from this model father.
Now, this, Jimmy, is a cutaway of an engine, a new Ford V8.
Why 8, Dad?
Yeah. A new Ford Y8.
Thunderbird Y8, Dad. You know, the engine that powers the Ford Thunderbird. Boy, is it terrific for quick getaways. And all the power you need for passing and hill climbing.
Yes. Well, now you'll find that this Thunderbird Y8 is
the engine they've taken from the Ford Thunderbird and put in the Ford family cars. It's the standard 8 for fair lanes and station wagons. And it doesn't cost anything extra. Right, Dad?
Right. And you'll also notice a number of other interesting things about this engine, Jimmy.
Like its deep block design?
Yes, exactly. Ford's new deep block design means that you, is capable of providing you with,
It means that the block extends deep below the crankshaft, Dad. See? It makes a Y. That makes the engine stronger and gives it more rigidity. So the engine runs smoother and quieter. It'll last a lot longer, too.
Well, that's true. But let me tell you something about Ford's electrical system.
Sure, Dad. Go ahead.
Now, all new Fords for 56 have, let's see now. How many volts was that?
12, Dad. It's a new 12-volt electrical system. That gives you faster starts, better all-around ignition, more power for the accessories, too.
Well, of course. And there's a new thingamajig here, too. See?
You mean the double twin-jet carburetor. Isn't that terrific, Dad? A four-barrel carburetor makes the engine breathe better for quick acceleration and sustained highway speeds. And that's not all. These are the new 18-millimeter spark plugs that go three times as long without fouling as ordinary plugs. And...
Is there anything else you'd like me to tell you about the new Ford, Jimmy?
Well, yes, Dad. Why isn't there one in our garage?
And now, Ford Star Jubilee presents Mary Martin and Noel Coward in Together with Music.
Together with music tonight.
introduced me to my first London audience. Being a Texan, I certainly know what the phrase Southern hospitality means. In London, I learned what friendship means. All my life, I shall cherish what Noel gave to me that night in the Drury Lane Theater in London. A deep and lasting love for his country and true admiration for Noel Coward. Tonight, I would like to share with you my delight in working with my friend Noel by introducing him to you, his first television audience, Mr. Noel Coward.
My family has traditions. I've heard them a thousand times. My relatives were not excessively bright. They love to go off on missions to rather peculiar climes and lead the wretched heathen to the light. A few of them got beaten up in course of these rampages. My great-aunt Maud got eaten up while singing A Rock of Ages. These family extensions admittedly are a bore, but there is just one encore that I positively adore. Poor Uncle Harry wanted to be a missionary, so he took a ship and sailed away. This visionary, hotly pursued by dear Aunt Mary, found a South Sea isle on which to stay. Now the natives greeted them kindly and invited them to dine on yams and clams and human hams and vintage coconut wine, the taste of which was filthy, but the after effects divine. Poor Uncle Harry got a bit gay and longed to tarry. This Aunt Mary couldn't quite allow. She lectured him severely on a number of church affairs. But when she'd gone to bed, he made a getaway down the stairs, for he longed to find the answer to a few of the maiden's prayers. Uncle Harry's not a missionary now. He's awfully happy, but he's certainly not a missionary now. Now, Uncle was just a seeker, a dreamer sincerely blessed of this. There couldn't be a shadow of doubt. The fact that his flesh was weaker than even Aunt Mary guessed took even her some time to figure out. In all those languid latitudes, the atmosphere's exotic. To take up moral attitudes would be too idiotic. Though no, he could be meeker than Uncle had been before. I'll bet today he's giving way at practically every pore. Poor Uncle Harry, having become a missionary, found the natives' morals rather crude. He and Aunt Mary swiftly imposed an arbitrary ban upon them shopping in the nude. Now, they all considered this silly, and they didn't take it well. They burnt his boots and several suits and wrecked the mission hotel. They also burnt his Macintosh, which made a disgusting smell. Poor Uncle Harry, after a chat with dear Aunt Mary, thought the time had come to make a row. He lined up all the older girls in one of the local sheds. And while he was reviling them and tearing himself to shreds, they took their mother hubbards off and tied them around their heads. Uncle Harry's not a missionary now. Poor Uncle Harry, after some words with dear Aunt Mary, called upon the chiefs for a powwow. Now, you know, they didn't brandish knives at him. They really were awfully sweet. They made concerted dives at him and offered him things to eat. But when they threw their wives at him, he had to admit defeat. Uncle Harry's not a missionary now. He's left the island, but he's certainly not a missionary now. Now I would like to sing you my own personal version of a very old Scottish ballad. On yon bonny banks and on yon bonny braes, where the sun shines bright on Loch Lomond, where me and my true love spent many happy days. On the bonny, bonny banks of Loch Lomond, for I'll take the high road and you take the low road, and I'll be in Scotland afore ye, and me and my true love
we'll ever meet again on the bonny, bonny banks of Loch Lomond. On yon bonny banks and on yon bonny braes, where the sun shines bright on Loch Lomond, where me and my true love spend many happy days, on the bonny, bonny banks of Loch Lomond. The high road is my road, the low road's a slow road. I'll guarantee ya, I'll be there to see ya on the bonny, bonny banks of Loch Lomond. For there with my honey, my bonny healing laddie, in his wee bitty kilt of Caledonian plaidy, he's my new love, my true love, my little sugar daddy. As we're hiccuping through the heather, together we cry, I'll take the high road and you take the low road. I'll be in Scotland afore ye, and me and my true love, and other friends as well, such as Katie, Connie, Frankie and Johnny, prepared for a roll in the hay, lolly lolly on the bonny, lolly lolly, friends of Loch Lomond. My next number requires a great deal of turgid tropical atmosphere, and thanks to the courtesy of the American Stagehands Union, I've been allowed to move my own scenery. Now this is a song about a lady from South America, a fairly disagreeable lady, who throughout her long and checkered existence resolutely refused to dance. Her name was Nina. Senorita Nina from Argentina knew all the answers, although her relatives and friends were perfect dancers. She swore she'd never dance a step until she died. She said, I've seen too many movies, and all they prove is too idiotic. They all insist that South America's exotic, whereas it couldn't be more boring if you tried. She added firmly that she hated the sound of foxy frogs beside a still lagoon. She also positively stated that she could not abide a southern moon. And she could not refrain from saying that that idiotic swaying and those flat guitarists swaying were an interest to her ears. And that she really couldn't face such international disgrace. She refused to begin the begin when they requested it. And she made an embarrassing scene if anyone suggested it. For she detested it. Though no one ever could be keen, the little Nina had quite a number of very eligible men who did the rumba. When they proposed her, she simply left them flat. She said that love should be impulsive, but not convulsive and syncopal. Had a discouraging effect on procreation, and that she'd rather read a book, and that was that. Nina from Argentina despised the tango, although she never was the girl to let a man go. She wouldn't sacrifice her principles for sex. She looked with scorn on the gyrations of her relations who did the conga, and said that if she had to stand it any longer, she'd lose all dignity and wring their silly necks. She said that frankly she was blinded to all that over-advertised romantic charm. And then she got more bloody-minded and told them where to put their tropic palm. She said, I hate to be pedantic, but it drives me nearly frantic when I see that unromantic, sycophantic lot of sluts forever wriggling their guts. It drives me absolutely nuts. She declined to begin the begin, though they besought her to. And in language profane and obscene, she cursed the man who taught her to.
She cursed Cole Porter, too. From this, it's fairly clear that Mina, her demeanor, was so offensive that when the hatred of her friends grew too intensive, she thought she'd better beat it while she had the chance. After some trial and tribulation, she reached the station and met a sailor who had acquired a wooden leg in Venezuela, and so she married him because he couldn't dance. So surely never could have been more irritating than Nina. They never speak in Argentina of this degenerate bambina who had the luck to find romance, but resolutely wouldn't dance. She wouldn't dance.
country met in Chicago for the 43rd Annual National Safety Congress. One of the speakers was Major Charles A. Speed, director of the Safety Division of the North Carolina Highway Patrol. He's flown to New York to be with us tonight. Major Speed, can you bring us up to date on what's being done about highway safety?
The Safety Congress came up with a new slogan this year, Be Your Brother's Keeper, Stop Accidents. And every state in the nation is working day and night to achieve that goal. But it's a big job, and accident prevention campaigns can't do it all. In North Carolina, we know we're getting the answers to several different kinds of accident problems.
What about the problem of accident injuries, Major?
For about 2 years now, North Carolina has been working very closely with the Cornell University Medical College on crash injury research. We photograph motor vehicle accidents in our state, then we fill out a complete accident report, send it with our photographs to Cornell. Our reports, along with the reports from other states, are compiled and analyzed to find out exactly how people get hurt in accidents.
And what have you learned about accident injuries, Major?
One thing we have definitely learned is that your chances of escaping injury are more than double when you remain inside the car in an accident.
But supposing the car doors fly open?
That's just the point. Even at impact speeds as low as 10 miles an hour, car doors with conventional latches often spring open in a collision. To prevent you from being thrown out of your car, safer latches are a must.
Well, Major Speed, here's what Ford has done about that need. Now, this is a door with a conventional door latch. It keeps the door tightly closed when the center post is rigid, but in a crash, the impact can spring the door frame and the door can fly open because the latch comes apart. But here's a door with Ford's new lifeguard door latches. Now, watch what happens this time when stress is applied to the center post. The door stays securely shut. Now, the reason is Ford's new lifeguard door latches have a double grip. When I close the door, the tooth rotor on the door meshes with the striker teeth on the body, holding the door safely shut under all normal conditions. Under abnormal stress, the door rotor is also restrained by a high-strength alloy steel plate, providing a double grip latch that can withstand forces from two directions. These new lifeguard double grip door latches are standard equipment on every 1956 Ford. They're an important part of Ford's new lifeguard design. Now, research also shows that 40% of accident injuries are caused by impact against the steering wheel apparatus. So Ford has developed this new lifeguard steering wheel, standard equipment on every 56 Ford. Now notice the deep center construction, the recessed steering post. In the event of a collision, these three spokes will bend, cushioning the impact and also helping to protect you from contact with the steering post. And to protect you from impact against hard interior surfaces, you can have the entire width of the instrument panel and the visors cushioned with this new lifeguard padding. And look, you can also have these new nylon seat belts. They're optional on all models. Ford's lifeguard design is the first major contribution to driver and passenger safety in the event of an accident. And it's exclusive with Ford in its field. But get the full story at your Ford dealers.
I still don't think it's wise.
Why not?
You'd be taking too much of a chance.
I believe in living dangerously.
So did Joan of Arc, and look what happened to her.
What's Joan of Arc got to do with it?
She overplayed her hand. She went too far.
You went to Las Vegas when everybody said you were mad to take such a chance, but you knew you could get away with it. You followed your star.
Actually, I followed Jane Powell.
No, this is just something I have always longed to do. Like Peter Pan.
You were wonderful as Peter Pan, darling. Everybody knows that. You were also wonderful in South Pacific and the whatever it is of your teeth.
Skin.
This is definitely not your dish.
Well, how do you know?
Well, you always hoot when you get above E-flat.
That is unkind. I have not hooted for years.
You haven't been above E-flat for years.
Only take 3 minutes. What 3 minutes out of 90?
Time enough for people to switch off their sets.
Now you're being rude.
I'm not being rude. I'm being realistic. The public want to see you doing what you can do better than anybody else in the world. In fact, they want to see Mary Martin being Mary Martin.
Well, I wasn't being Mary Martin when I was being Peter Pan.
I wish you'd never heard of Peter Pan. I wish Peter Pan had never been written. I am sick to death of Peter Pan.
What a wicked, disloyal thing to say.
Disloyal, my foot.
You who were brought up on Peter Pan. You who played in it before I was even born.
Mary, I did not play in Peter Pan before you were even born. I may have played in it while you were being born. But definitely not before. Anyway, I was a tiny little boy at the time.
I don't believe you were ever a tiny little boy.
I most certainly was. I can show you a photograph of myself at the age of 8 months, naked on a cushion.
Very decadent.
Nonsense. I didn't become decadent till years later.
Well, anyway, you couldn't have played in Peter Pan naked on a cushion.
I didn't say I played in Peter Pan naked on a cushion. All I was
this
trying to...
This is not getting us any place.
Maybe not, but it's filling in time.
90 minutes is a long, long time. A long, long time. A long, long time.
We need the Rockettes and the Marionettes and a ballet on ice supporting us.
When we visualize all those millions of eyes and those millions of screens distorting
oh,
us, don't
imagine it's a bagatelle to cast a spell. We know darn well whenever a song goes on too long, it isn't worth a dime. But 90 minutes is a long, long time. 90 minutes is a long time.
Mary Martin and Noel Coward will return in a moment on the CBS Television Network.
Have you heard about the new Thunderbird styling?
Have you heard about the new Thunderbird Y8 engine?
Have you heard about that new lifeguard design?
You mean in the 1956 Ford?
Let's go down to our Ford dealers and see it.
It's a deal.
You too will be carried away by the 1956 Ford. Visit your Ford dealer soon. Watch Channel 2. More people do.
Ladies and gentlemen, I would like to sing you a brief medley of some of my old songs, some of which I hope some of you may remember.
I'll see you again whenever spring breaks through again. Time may lie heavy between, but what has been is past forgetting.
Dance, 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 little lady, you just sleep until the rhythm beating in your mind. Dance, 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 little lady, so obsessed with second best, no rest you'll ever find. Time and tide and trouble never, never wait. Let the cauldron bubble, justify your fate. Dance, 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 little lady, dance, 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 little lady. Leave tomorrow behind. The life you lead sets all your nerves a-jangle. Your love affairs are in a hopeless tangle. Though you're a child, dear, your life's a wild typhoon. In lives of leisure, the craze for pleasure steadily grows. Cocktails and laughter, but what comes after, nobody knows.
You're weaving love into a mad jazz pattern ruled by Pantaloon. Poor little rich girl, don't drop a stitch too soon. We'll be as happy and contented as birds upon a tree, high above the mountains and sea. We'll bill and we'll coo, and sorrow will never come. Oh, will it ever come to our room with a view? Someday I'll find you, right behind me, true to the dream I am dreaming. As I draw near you, you'll smile a little smile. For a little while, we shall stand hand in hand. I'll follow my secret heart my whole life through. I'll keep all my dreams apart till one comes to. No matter what price is paid, what stars may fade above, I'll follow my secret heart till I find love. For I believe that since my life began, the most I've had is just a talent to amuse. Hey ho, if love were all. Play orchestra, play. Play something light and sweet and gay. Oh, we must have music, we must have music to drive our fears away. While our illusions swiftly fade for us, let's have an orchestra score. In the confusion the years have made for us, serenade for us just once more. Life needn't be grey, though it is changing day by day. Though a few old dreams may decay. Play orchestra, play orchestra, play orchestra, play.
Now, ladies and gentlemen, I would like to sing you a song that I wrote long ago and far away. The name of it is Mad Dogs and Englishmen. In tropical climes, there are certain times of day when all the citizens retire to tear their clothes off and perspire. You know, it's one of those rules that the greatest fools obey, because the sun is far too sultry and one must avoid the buttery violet rain. Pap like a pap like a pap like a boo, that's natives if you're interested. Digga-digga-digga-digga-digga-digga-doo. The natives grieve when the white men leave their huts, because they're obviously, definitely nuts. Mad dogs and Englishmen go out in the midday sun, the Japanese don't care, the Chinese wouldn't dare to. Hindus and Argentines sleep firmly from 12 to 1, but Englishmen detest a siesta. You know, in the Philippines, they have lovely screens to protect you from the glare, and the Malay states their hats like plates, which the Britishers won't wear at 12 noon. The natives swoon, and no further work is done. But mad dogs and Englishmen go out to the midday sun. Oh, it's such a surprise for the Eastern eyes to see that though the English are effete, they're quite impervious to heat. When the white man rides, every native hides in glee, because the simple creatures hope he will impale his soul atopy on the tree. Heaven in heaven in heaven in hearts, the same natives pay no attention. It seems a shame when the English claim the earth, that they give rise to such hilarity and mirth. Oh dear. Mad dogs and Englishmen go out in the midday sun. You know, the smallest Malay rabbit deplores this foolish habit in Hong Kong. They strike a gong and fire off a noonday gun to reprimand each inmate who's in late. In a jungle town where the sun beats down to the rage of man and beast, the English garb of the English Saab merely gets a bit more creased. In Bangkok, at 12 o'clock, they foam at the mouth and run. But mad dogs and Englishmen go out to the midday sun. Mad dogs and Englishmen go out in the midday sun. The toughest Burmese bandit can never understand. In Rangoon, the heat of noon is just what the natives shun. They put their scotch or rye down and lie down. In the jungle swamps where the python romps for his peace from 12 till 2, even caribous lie around and snooze with nothing else to do. In Bengal, to move at all is seldom, if ever, done. But mad dogs and Englishmen go out to the midday, 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 out to the midday.
Oh, is this? What's going to happen to the children when there aren't any more grown-ups?
Well, when Grandmama, without getting out of breath, starts to jive at 85 and frightens the little ones to death, the police had to send a squad car when Daddy got fried on vodka and tied a tweed coat round his throat and stepped his
Ladies and gentlemen, Miss Mary Martin will now sing One Fine Day, the aria from Madame Butterfly by Giacomo Puccini.
To meet wait there. And wait for a long time, but never weary of a long waiting. From out the crowded city there is coming a man a little speck in the distance, climbing the hillock. Can you guess who he is? And when he's reached his summit, can you guess what he'll say? He will say, he will say,
butterfly, dear.
Butterfly. I, without answering, hold myself quietly concealed. A bit to tease him, and a bit so as not to do.
Dear baby wife of mine, dear little orange blossom.
Dear baby wife of mine, my little orange blossom. The names he used to call me when he came here.
Follow a number like that. It's unfair to Wilker Chase.
And have you noticed what Mary Martin's had on? Mame Beauchet has a genuine talent for expressing a woman's personality in clothes. Of course, clothes aren't a woman's only means of self-expression. There's her house, the way she decorates it. And what I always say is, a car is basically an extension of her personality, too. That's why it's so important to have a wide choice of upholstery. And the finest quality fabrics that a car could wear were especially designed just for the 56 Ford. You know, those Ford people, they honestly went through thousands of tested materials just for you and me. Now, here's a red mosaic pattern, for instance, offered in the three new Ford Victorias. A green wave cloth, available in all custom line models. And here's the white quilted vinyl, offered in the new Sunliner. Mighty swank. But let's face it, you really have to see these new fabrics in the 56 Ford in order, honestly, to appreciate them. Let's look inside the Sunliner, huh? Uh-oh. This is the kind of thing that happens. Dirty little paw marks. And you, my son, are the dirty little culprit who did it, too. Yes, you bad egg. I'm ashamed of you. Go on home. I have to tell him that for discipline. But as far as the car is concerned, you haven't a care in the world. See? And all stains and dirt vanish just as easily. And see this smart trim inside the door? It sets off the whole rest of the interior. And this is only one of the 58 color and trim schemes that Ford is offering. And all the colors match beautifully inside and out. It's a veritable symphony. Handsome two-toned instrument panel. Pretty nice, huh? And as for Ford's exterior styling, oh boy, that suits me to a T. T for Thunderbird. Because those long, low, luscious lines, wow, could only have been inspired by the Thunderbird, the most beautiful car in the land. And see if you don't agree when you first set eyes on the 56 models at your Ford dealers. And when you buy a new Ford, you're proving what smart people, and I use the word in both senses, fashionable and brainy, what smart people have always known. Taste and know-how are just as important as cost. And that's why everyone's saying that the 56 Ford is the fine car at half the fine car price.
say I told you so, I shall never speak to you again.
You look like a Japanese bullfighter. No use upsetting yourself. You were determined to do it, and you did it. As Winston Churchill once very wisely remarked, it is waste of time to indulge in useless recriminations.
Winston Churchill didn't try to sing Butterfly.
He may have privately. He's devoted to music.
Anyway, he didn't have you prompting him at all the wrong moments.
I only prompted you, Mary, when it was quite apparent that you were dried up, dead.
I just loathe being prompted. Whenever I go to the Metropolitan Opera and see that dreadful prompter's box in the middle of the stage, it just sets me off. That's one of the reasons I never did take up opera seriously.
I can think of several other reasons.
Well, I should have been all right if you hadn't gone crashing about with that stick.
I was getting the baby out of the way. You had discarded it in the most callous manner. Even the most depraved Japanese geishas don't leave their babies just lying about on the floor.
Oh, Plop.
Now, you're saying, oh, Plop. In America, mother love is a very sacred thing. You've probably outraged the feelings of millions of people. I expect at this very minute there are hordes of furious ladies crouching over their writing desks in Nebraska, scribbling notes of protest.
There aren't all that many writing desks in Nebraska. It's an agricultural state.
There's no use arguing about it now. The commercial's nearly over, and we've still got a long way to go.
Double Plop.
90 minutes is a long, long time. A long, long time. A long, long time.
We hope for success, but we have to confess our sponsors have spent a lot on us.
Some talented fleas on a flying trapeze might be certainly less monotonous, don't you? Imagine that we've lost our nerve.
But please observe, we here to serve. A musical feast that should at least appear to mean sublime. But 90 minutes is a long, long time. 90 minutes is a long time.
Something remembered long ago.
And of course we know everything's bound to be right. I gave you what we see because of long, long life we happen to be together with you.
You know, you have written so many wonderful, wonderful words and tunes. And there's one song in particular that means the most to me. Would you sit down and let me sing it for you?
London pride has been handed down to me. London pride is a flower that's free. London pride means your own dear town to me, and my pride it forever will be. Well, life, see the Costa barrow, vegetable marrows, and the fruit piled high. Oh, life, little London sparrows, Covent Garden Market, where the costers cry.
Cockney feet mark the beat of history. Every street pins a memory down. Early rain and the pavement glistening. All Park Lane in a shimmering gown. Hey, lady, when the day is dawning, see the policeman yawning on his lonely beat. Gay lady, Mayfair in the morning, hear the footsteps echo on the empty street. London pride has been handed down to me. London pride is a flower that's free. London pride means your own dear town to me. And my pride, it forever will be.
Thank you, darling. That was a very, very sweet gesture. I wish I could repay it. But all I can do is I'll sing you a little song that I've learned from your own neck of the woods. The stars at night are big and bright. Deep in the heart of Texas, the prairie sky is wide and high. Deep in the heart of Texas, the sage in blue is like curfew. Deep in the heart of Texas, reminds me of the one I love. Deep in the heart of Texas, the husbands roam, go stopping, the wives go shopping. Year after year, the program never changes. Though Texans can become stinking, every man without thinking just gallivants out, wearing his pants out, riding on them ranges. Watch them coming round the mountain, always coming round that mountain, and it really couldn't be a greater bore. When they yell loud and strong, yippee, some cowboy song. And whatever high notes they aim to hit, they always inevitably end with get along, little doggie. Get along, little doggie, get along. In Texas, they've only got the Brazos River. And they like a tune with wow and zip in it, something with some bip, yip in it. Rhythm has them rolling on the floor. We first heard some blue notes, somebody played a few notes, Texan asked for any more. How I'd love a chart of how they brought the art of bebop to the heart of Texas. Bebop, mambo, samba, conga, to day by day the urge is stronger to give those guys who don't like fun around one big Texan rhythmic run around. Give them something to collapse about when those cowboys flap their chaps about. Deep, 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 deep in the sleepy heart of Texas.
From deep in the heart of this Texan. The ones we used to play so long ago. Get out those old records, those old phonograph records, the ones we used to play so long ago. What if they sound crappy? The tunes really were catchy. Remember how we used to love them so.
They bring the past right into the present, and they make the future shine.
Forever one of them, each single one of them, a vocal valentine.
Get out those old records,
those old phonograph records. No ones we used to play so long ago. Ho, 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 ho.
I remember them all.
Bo-ho-da-lay.
I can also recall.
Bo-ho-da-lay.
How you turned down every laddie. With my heart belongs to deity.
I've a married two. I'm a room with a view. And that rather obsolete waltz.
Could you mean the bittersweet waltz?
Mm-hmm. Bo-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-
road. So long, phonograph records, the ones we used to play so long ago. The ones we used to play so long ago. Like when I told them how wonderful you are.
Oh, dear Jerry Kern.
They didn't believe me. They didn't believe me.
What's the middle bit? Your lips, your eyes, your face, your hair are in a class beyond compare. You're the loveliest thing that man could see.
And when I tell them, and I'm certainly gonna tell them, that I'm a boy whose girl one day I'll be, they'll never believe me. How could they believe me? That from this great big world you chose me.
It's wonderful.
Oh, wonderful.
Marvelous.
It's Gershwin, too.
That you should care for me. Awful
night. Awful night.
Paradise.
Paradise.
What I love to see.
You made my life so glamorous. Don't blame me for being amorous. It's wonderful. You should care for me. I'm on my head.
The silent stars are
you in my arms.
The romantic spell this moment has bound
nothing
us.
Nothing but love.
Beneath the sky of midnight blue.
And if you fall,
the stars are almost fading.
Once and for
I almost hear the nightingale serenading.
We'll have our
he
dreams.
He seems to want to help us.
Come true.
So you mustn't laugh at me, for I never knew what time it was. Life was no prize. I wanted love, and there it was, shining out of your eyes.
I'm wise, and I know what time it is now.
Anything goes. The world has gone mad today, and the world's mad today, and that's right today, and day's night today, and those skies, days, the wind arrives today. I just stop, you go low. And though I'm not a great romancer, I know I'm bound to answer when you propose. Anything goes.
Would you care to dance?
I can't wait.
Dancing in the dark. Still a few minutes, we're dancing in the dark. And it soon ends, we're waltzing in the wonder of why we're here. Time hurries by,
we're here.
And dance, ballerina, dance.
I won't dance, don't ask me. I won't dance, don't ask me.
Why won't you dance with me? Come on and dance with me.
Charleston. Hey, hey, I can Charleston.
Oh, you can too. You're lovely with that breathless charm.
That's the way I feel tonight.
You're an old movie, and I'm an old softy.
I'm just like putty in the hands of a gal like you.
He's young and foolish,
but I'm always true to you, darling, in my fashion.
Stomping all around, stomping all around, stomping all around. You're clumsy.
Little Japanese sandman, creeping on with the dew.
That's the way you look tonight.
Shall we dance?
But of course.
On a bright cloud of music, shall we fly?
Shall we dance? Well, good. That's it. That we can't control. We will do the continental all the time. Sing your thrill of beautiful music. The
Jubilee program starring Lloyd Nolan and Barry Sullivan in the first television presentation of Paul Gregory's Broadway production, The Kane Mutiny Court Martial. The Ford Star
Jubilees was brought to you by the Ford Division of the Ford Motor Company. Next week, in this hour and a half, Chesterfield will bring you Gunsmoke. P&G will present It's Always Jam. And Budweiser, the Damon Runyon Theater. So tune in next Saturday night for these programs over most of the same stations. Much of the material on this program is from the Columbia album, Noel Coward at Las Vegas, which can be obtained at your local record store. Miss Martin's Jewelry by Harry Winston.